And to make it more accessible, what I'll do is I'll read the English translation first, and then I'll say the. So the punch of English. Save my tongue, the Savior's glory, of his flesh, the mystery sin, of the blood, all price exceeding, shed by our immortal King, destined for the world's redemption from a noble womb of spring. Pange lingua gloriosi, corporis misterium, sanguinisque preciosi, veri mundi precium, frutus ventris generosi, prece fulgentium. Of a pure and spotless virgin born for us on earth below, he, as man with man conversing, stayed the seeds of truth to sow. Then he closed in solemn order, wondrously his life abode. Nobis datus, nobis natus, ex intacta virgine, et immuno conversatus, sparso verbi semine, sui moras incolatus, miro plausitor vive. On the night of that last supper, seated with his chosen band, he, the paschal victim eating, first fulfills the law's command. Then, as true to his apostles, gives himself with his own hand. In supreme docte cede, recubet cum fratrius, observata lece plene, civis in legalimus, circum turbe dodene, sedat suis manibus. Word with flesh, the bread of nature, by his word to flesh he curves. Wine into his blood he changes. What, no sense, no change to service. Only be the heart in earnest, faith her lesson quickly learns.
Verbum caro, panem verum, verbo carne me pici, pique sanguis Christi merum, petsi sensus deficiti, ad firmantum cor sincero, sola fide sodici.
Down in adoration falling, this great sacrament we hail, or ancient forms of worship, newer rites of grace prevail. Faith will tell us Christ is present when our human senses fail.
Tantum ergo sacramentum veneremur cervui, et anticum documentum novo cerdatui tui. Reste fides nuclementum sensum defectum.
The everlasting Father, and the Son who made us free, and the Spirit, God proceeding from them each eternally, be salvation, honor, blessing, might, and endless majesty. Amen.
Genitori, genitorque, laus et jubilatio, salus honor virtus quoque, sit et benedictio, procedenti ab utroque, comparsit laudatio. Amen.
chapel service. This is our service for Holy Week. You'll notice that I'm wearing red. The service sheets are in red. That's the liturgical color for Holy Week, the color of spirit, the color of sacrifice. And this is the story of Jesus' ultimate sacrifice for us. What we're going to do, it's a bit of a different service in the sense of it's not traditional in the liturgy, in that it's combining storytelling with some dramatizations, with some songs, as well as some hymns that we'll sing together, and prayers to kind of tell the story of Jesus' last week on earth. One thing to be aware of in the story of Jesus' last week is that there's two layers to his story. There is the political, social, political layer of what was happening, as well as the spiritual layer. Now, the social, political layer, we have to understand that this is a context where Jesus lived. He was Jewish. The Jewish people were under the power of the Roman Empire, the Pax Romana. Roman peace, which was actually an ironic term because they kept peace through domination, through force. That's the first thing we have to understand. And then we have this man Jesus, God on earth, God incarnate, God becoming one with us, to be one with us, to understand who we are, but also to teach us a way, the path of God. And all that we learn in this chapel about Jesus' life, the stories, the miracles, the healings, the teachings, they all represent Jesus trying to help us understand what it means to be in relationship with God, what it means for God to be in relationship with us. But there's a cost to that, because his message was one that got him in trouble with both Jewish authorities and Roman authorities. And that will come through very strongly as we journey from his triumphal entry into Jerusalem through to his arrest and his trial and his crucifixion. When he came in as on a donkey into Jerusalem the week before his death at the eve of the Passover, what people would expect at that time would be like a warrior king. Yet Jesus riding a war horse with a big army behind him. Yet Jesus rides in humility with symbols of peace, palm branches, and cloaks down for him. His first kind of act of what you might call defiance or a counterpoint to the system of domination that was around him. And then we move into the story of the overturning of the tables in the temple. What he saw as a religious practice turned into a money-making venture, which he was thought was horrific, and into his arrest and trial. And then, of course, there is the spiritual dimension. Jesus dying on the night of Passover, the Jewish celebration, when they recognized their freedom from bondage into slavery into freedom, with Moses leading them across the Red Sea. And in Jesus, we have a story of self-sacrifice to give us our spiritual freedom, a freedom to love, a freedom to hope, a freedom of joy, a freedom to recognize God's unending presence and abiding presence with us. A couple things more about the service. We do ask that you show an extra sense. You're always respectful of this chapel, but especially so. There are some different performances in here, and there will be the odd time and odd giggle or things like that, but I ask that you maintain your composure and respect for the service overall. And I would ask you, please, no clapping. This is, while there are performances, this is a service. This is a service, a very somber service in many ways, a service on the most important week in the Christian calendar. So I do ask that you, I know you're very appreciative of what people put in here, but please make sure that you refrain from any kind of applause during the service. We'll take a moment of silence and reflection, and then we'll begin. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a foal, the foal of a donkey. As the people spread their coats and palm branches on the ground to welcome Jesus into Jerusalem, so we welcome him into our lives this morning. King of glory, King of peace, Servant King, reign in our hearts and lives this day and all days, that we might praise your holy name. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Way of the Lord. Thank you. day of mountain motion, the day of blunt nails and splintered wood, of bruised flesh and red blood, the day we loathe and hopes are crushed, the day we long for when contempt fall away, because the worst that we can do cannot kill the love of God. Gracious God, your love is a light in our darkness, vulnerable yet unsensible. We would stand with Christ in the midst of the horrors of this world, where betrayal and death constantly threaten your love and truth. Amen.
Come to the confession, the recognition that we're not perfect, we make mistakes, sometimes with difficult consequences. But we have a God who loves us unconditionally. And with that in mind, Lord Jesus Christ, we confess we have failed you as did your first disciples. We ask for your mercy and your help. Our selfishness betrays you. Lord, forgive us. We fail to share the pain of your suffering. Lord, forgive us. We run away from those who abuse you. Lord, forgive us. We are afraid of being known to belong to you. Lord, forgive us. God forgives you. Forgive yourselves. Forgive one another.
Thank you.
back, old man. Are you comfortable? Turn back, old man.
He turned the tables on Monday. oppression was done by religious people who thought they were doing the right thing. We've come knowing that we ourselves would have done the same. But we believe, and in the life of Christ we see, that the love of God is greater than the sin of the world. That is the hope which takes us through the suffering and death of Jesus to the joy of his resurrection. He grew up before the Lord like a young plant whose roots are in dry ground. He had no beauty, no majesty to draw our eyes, no grace to make us delight in him. His form, disfigured, lost all likeness of a man. His beauty changed beyond all recognition. He was despised. He shrank from the sight of people, tormented and humbled by suffering. We despised him. We held him of no account, a thing from which people turn away their eyes. Yet he himself bore our sufferings, our torments he endured, while we thought he was punished by God, struck down by disease and misery. We had all strayed like sheep. Each of us had gone our own way, but the Lord laid on him the guilt of us all.
As high priest, I am the official guardian of our traditional and orthodox religion. It is my duty to investigate heresies and to discipline heretics and any other who would choose to revert to our faith. I have been summoned this day to investigate complaints against one, Jesus, from the town of Nazareth in Galilee. So let me hear the accusations. Who are the witnesses for the prosecution?
I am one, sir.
Who are you?
My name is Shad. I am from the Ed, your father-in-law. I changed foreign currency to this new currency.
What have you said?
I am from your Lord's death. He, that man, Jesus, he said he would destroy our temple.
What?
He said he would bring down the temple, destroy it.
Did you hear him say that?
No, that is not personal. But I know someone who did, and they told me, and I told him, and that's why I'm here.
And how exactly was he going to destroy the temple?
I'm not sure, but I have an idea. A lot of people know him, a lot of people follow him, and a lot of people listen to him. If they get his miracle, they'll do anything.
Who are these people?
The lower classes, sir. The crowds, the rabble.
Anything else?
Well, there was a rumor about him, and it certainly wasn't correct. But I'm not one of those awesome, but I wouldn't be surprised.
Be seated. Now, anyone else? Who had us as information?
Me, sir. I have information.
Who are you?
My name is Joelbad. I'm a friend of Dennis, your father-in-law. I'm a cleaner in the temple.
What have you to say?
Here it is. I have it here. I also wrote it down. I did not want to forget. Yes, it says, that man, Jesus. He said he would build another temple.
Build another temple?
Yes, in 3 days.
Do you expect me to believe that?
It's true, sir. That's what he said.
Did you hear him say it?
Well, yes and no. You see, I was standing on the edge of the crowd, but I could not hear anything. I could only hear a few words now and then. So I asked him to stand closer, and that's what he told me.
And you believe this man?
Yes, of course. He, Jesus, that is, he does tricks. He does magic tricks. He does tricks with bread and fish. He does tricks with trees. Personally, I
think
he works for the devil. You'll build another temple in 3 days if you want to. But it will be the temple of Satan.
Did he say that?
Does he have to? Isn't it obvious, sir?
Anything else?
Yes. I don't know if I should say anything in the face, but he talks with prostitutes. Oh, yes. I know for a fact. I see the kind of company he keeps.
Take your seat. Who else?
There's me.
Your name, please.
I am Anas, and I am your father-in-law. I have much to do with religion, like you, and I have much to say about this man. Firstly, you have heard what he has said about the temple. I admit, the information is not clear, but it is enough, surely, to convince you that he is a threat the life of our beloved institution. Secondly, he's a threat to our national security. We live at peace under the Roman government. We pay our taxes. We behave responsibly. We gain the benefits of a Roman civilization. We respect Pilate, our governor. We respect Caesar, our emperor, although we don't worship him as others do. We value the peace and progress we have in our country. And then comes along this man, questioning Caesar's authority, saying to the people, give to Caesar what belongs to him. These more or less are his words. Now, what have you that belongs to Caesar, and what have I? Do we have Caesar's furniture? Caesar's palaces? Caesar's slaves and Caesar's books? Of course not. The conclusion, as I understand it, is that because we have nothing belonging to Caesar, we should forget about him. But let us forget about Caesar for 1 minute, and he will not forget us. No, we will suffer for our lack of memory. The man is a nationalist of the worst variety, for he's a threat to our nation's peace. And thirdly, he's a threat to our religion, for he claims to be the Messiah. This traitor has been tricking the faithful of our religion, turning their minds away from the true worship, encouraging them to believe that he and his philosophies were set from God. This tradesman and his 12 ignorant companions have been encouraging immoral practices, breaking the law of the Sabbath, questioning the authority of the priests, preaching heresy.
Stop. Is this true? Is this all true? Are you the Messiah? Speak, man!
These are your words.
These are my words. These are your words. These words are blasphemy. Pilate!
Yes, King.
Your Excellency, this is the day before our holy celebration, our Passover. On this day, our nation rids itself of anything that's unclean or foul. So on this day, I bring you this foul man. I have no authority to prescribe the punishment, which is most fitting. But in your hands there lies the will. It is him he deserves.
Why? What has he done?
Three things. He's a threat to our nation and our religion, for he questions and breaks the rules of our faith. He's opposed to paying the taxes to Caesar, and he sets himself up as a rival of power. He claims to be our king. He says that he is our Messiah. As high priest, I know he's not. But I fear the wickedness that may follow if this man is left to live.
That is him.
His name is Jesus.
Your name is Jesus. You've turned on his instead of you. Now, what do you say to your friends? I repeat. You've heard of his instead of you. Now, what do you say in your defense? Look here, man. Your life is at risk. Are you not going to defend yourself? Let me make myself clear. You have been brought to me on several charges. These charges are made by your religious authorities. Now, I'm not a Jew. I do not worship your God. Religious matters are not even interesting. But because the Jews have no courts of their own, I have to administer justice for them. If this were an ordinary trial, if you had stolen some sheep or killed a man, I would know what to do. But religious heretics and Jewish messiahs only confuse me. I have no complaints about you from the police or the army, only from your religious beliefs. In your eyes, not mine, you are guilty. If you can convince me otherwise, I can prepare to let you go. Now, what do I have to say? Speak, man! What have you got to say? Under Roman law, I cannot find this man guilty. But if he has caused trouble to you and to your establishment, I am prepared to have him flogged and set free.
No, Barabbas!
No!
No, Barabbas!
No, Barabbas!
No, Barabbas!
Then what am I to do with this man?
Crucify him!
Crucify him!
Crucify him!
Crucify your king?
He is not our king! Mosaic is our king! Rubbish! Lies! Lies! Lies!
He is not our king. Caesar is. And you, Caesar's double.
Then, if he must be crucified, he must be crucified. In my hands lies the authority for his death. But in your hands, I leave the responsibility.
did not open his mouth. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, like a ewe that is dumb before her shearers. Without protection, without justice, he was taken away, and who even thought to his fate? He was cut off from the world of the living, put to death for the people's sin. He was given a grave for the wicked, a burial place among the rubbish of humanity, though he had done nothing wrong and said nothing which was untrue.
Thank you. observe you. Strung up between criminals, cursed and spat upon. You wait for death and look for us. For us whose sin has crucified you. To the mystery of undeserved suffering, you bring the deeper mystery of unmerited love. Forgive us for not knowing what we have done. Open our eyes to what we are doing now, as, through wooden nails, you disempower our depravity and transform us by your grace. Amen. Thank you.